Good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies from David Torrance and James Dornan will be joining us as a substitute. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 to 6 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The second item on our agenda is an update from the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport on the National Care Service Scotland Bill. For this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Marie Todd, Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport, Donna Bell, Director of Social Care and National Care Service Development, and Rachel McGruer, Deputy Director of Social Care and National Care Service Development and from Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much for inviting me to provide an update on the NCS Bill. During the summer, we've used the time to respond to stakeholder concerns. We've agreed proposed changes to the overarching structure of the NCS, which will help to achieve our ambition of improving quality and consistency of social services. We've also carried out extensive co-design engagement across Scotland to understand how to achieve the change that is needed. And after being out and about over the summer speaking with people, I know more than ever that the status quo is not an option. We must act decisively so that people can have the improvements that they need as quickly as possible. We must make wise decisions in a new fiscal environment where resources are under pressure. This is not an easy task. However, we are absolutely committed to getting it right by listening to the voices of experience. I'd like to outline how we propose to go forward, having listened carefully to these voices. In my recent letter to the committee, I described our extensive summer programme of local co-design activity. We held regional events across Scotland and online. Hundreds of people participated, sharing valuable and diverse feedback on the NCS. I attended several events in person, and I'd like to take this opportunity to thank everyone wholeheartedly for sharing their experiences and knowledge. We've now published our analysis of these events. These will shape both our thinking going forward and the second NCS National Forum on the 30th of October. Our other major discussions over summer have been with COSLA, the NHS and trade unions. We've reached initial consensus on a partnership approach with COSLA in July, which will provide shared legal accountability for integrated health and social care services. Those discussions are still continuing, developing more detail which will inform our proposed amendments to the bill. It's important that we have effective national oversight and governance to drive consistency and improved outcomes for the people who access support. The proposed NCS National Board will provide that. At local level, local government and NHS boards will retain statutory delivery functions and the staff and assets to deliver services. We're considering how local integration structures can be reformed and strengthened as part of the NCS. Additionally, we are discussing the bill and current challenges in social care regularly with trade unions. Although we are limited in legislating on employment, we are committed to promoting fair work as far as possible through ethical commissioning and procurement. We'll also provide funding to increase the pay of social care workers and improve workforce planning, practice and culture. We'll also take the trade union views on issues such as workforce representation into account when designing the national board and local delivery. In summary, it's been a very busy summer with many productive discussions and positive developments. I hope that's a useful overview before our discussion.
Thank you very much, Minister, and thank you for attending committee today. As you say, it obviously has been a very busy summer with a lot of engagement across the country. I wonder if you could expand a little bit on some of what you said there in your opening statement about the impact the accord with COSLA will have about shared accountability and what impact that will have on the National Care Service and the relevant provisions in the bill.
So the shared accountability, really, there's a couple of important things to draw out about that. So it's shared accountability rather than joint accountability. That's a significant distinction because we have different groups to whom we are accountable. So as ministers, we are accountable to the country. Local authorities are accountable only to the local authority that they represent, and the National Health Service is accountable to the board. So we all have different groups to whom we are accountable. But if we share that accountability, we do get really good coverage and really good oversight of the country. And I think the three of us together will definitely be able to deliver an impact in terms of delivery of better standards and better qualities. I think the National Care Board, and we're still working out the detail, I don't think that it's just going to be the three of us. I think there will be more people around that table. I would expect there probably to be an independent chair. I personally think the voice of lived experience is absolutely vital on that board. I think that representation for the workforce, representation from the National Social Work Agency, these are the things that will give that board teeth and make sure that it delivers an impact. So I've heard many people criticise that it's just the status quo, but it is different. At the moment, I have no control over the social care system. I'm held to account day in, day out for things over which I have no control over. In future, Scottish Government ministers will have some control. They will share that with a national body who will absolutely ensure that we deliver improved standards.
Thank you for that. I suppose you've actually covered a little bit of my next question, and this is an issue that has been raised with me as an MSP, I'm sure with yourself as Minister, about individuals saying that they're disappointed that accountability will be shared, because that was one of the recommendations of the Feely report, was that there would be ministerial responsibility, and concern that if that responsibility and accountability is shared, that it will, that they'll continue the existing postcode lottery as people see it, of access to care services. So how will you ensure that that's not the case?
So I absolutely hear that criticism loud and clear, and I hear it very directly because we are engaging so closely with people with lived experience of accessing care, and undoubtedly there are many people for whom that access has been traumatic and disappointing, and they are absolutely clear that change is required. I am absolutely clear that change is required as well, and as I say, this shared accountability, which we foresee, I think will give ministers control over the system whilst ensuring that delivery locally is still done by the local democratically elected body. And I think that's probably the best combination. It's really important that that board has power to take action when there is system delivery failure, and I'm determined to reassure people that it will have sufficient power to take action when it needs to. And we're envisaging something similar to the arrangements that are in place for health boards at the moment, where there can be interventions if there are challenges and an escalation of intervention. We're envisaging something similar for the National Care Service, and that board will have the power to intervene.
Okay, thank you. And can I ask what would become of health and social care partnerships and how they would relate to National Care Board in terms of governance?
So again, we haven't quite, we're still in the thick of discussing the local governance arrangements, and I might ask officials to come in a little bit on this in case I've missed anything in all of the answers that I've given. But I would envisage that the structures that are already there will be strengthened. What we have at the moment is quite a disparate pattern of integration, which is one of the reasons that we have that postcode lottery. So in some parts of the country, there is more integration than others, and that probably isn't serving us particularly well. So I think there will be a move towards more integration all over the country, and the integrated joint boards and the HSCPs, the structure will evolve and probably strengthen to oversee the local delivery of social care. Do you want to come in first?
Yeah, just very briefly, and I think there is a distinction to be made between the integration joint board and the health and social care partnership, because the integration joint board obviously has a legal foundation, whereas the health and social care partnership is essentially a way of working, and sometimes that creates a bit of confusion. So one of the things that I think we're quite keen to do is bring a bit of clarity around those accountabilities and how all that works as we go along.
Okay, did you want to bring in your other official here?
Do you want to add anything, Rachel?
No, it's just to reiterate what the Minister said, is the discussions are underway to work out exactly how we can strengthen local integration under this model.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to move to Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener. In the programme for government, there was a pledge to set £12 an hour as a minimum rate of pay for all social care and support staff. How will this be implemented effectively?
So over the last number of years, actually, we have effectively introduced a floor level for payment of social care staff. So we've introduced that nationally, and we've done that by providing the funding to ensure that that can be passed on to staff. So I think we will manage to do that effectively again, this time using those same mechanisms that we've used for a number of years. I am absolutely delighted that we are delivering on that commitment. I know, as ever, people are pushing for more and would like to see even better pay in social care. I absolutely am delighted that we are delivering, given the financial constraints that we are facing as a nation. I'm delighted that we're delivering. I'm delighted that we're setting a path where we are seeing year on year that significant improvement in pay to social care staff, because I think that's one of the really important things we need to do to strengthen the system as a whole.
Thank you, Minister. How can ethical commissioning change the nature of contract competition?
So I think, one of the challenges that we have in the Scottish Government is that we do not have control over employment law, and there are many changes that we would like to see in the employment of social care staff in the sector, and we don't have the powers to directly intervene. Ethical commissioning gives us some power to ensure that where we are using public money, staff are treated well. And that's an important part of what we're hoping to achieve with the National Care Service. When I think about this change that we are trying to achieve, the two groups of people I have in mind day in, day out are the people who are accessing care, from whom I hear just how difficult that can be every day, and the people who are working in social care. And I'm pretty confident that ethical commissioning gives us a tool with which to improve their pay and conditions and voice, and build in some fair work principles into the procurement process. Again, I'm not sure, Donna, if you want to say a little bit more about that.
Yeah, happy to do so. Current procurement legislation already provides the opportunity for ethical commissioning. The National Care Service Bill, as introduced, places duties both on ministers and on care boards to produce ethical commissioning strategies as part of their strategic plans, which I think is a key part of implementation. And there will be an opportunity through that to support consistency and enable us really to focus on those important issues that the Minister's already picked up. We do still have some detail to work through on exactly what those ethical commissioning strategies will look like, the expectations that sit behind them and then implementation. But certainly I think it's a very important step towards embedding this in all of our practice in social care and beyond.
Thank you.
Now going to move to Carol Malkin, who's joining us remotely.
Morning, thank you. I am interested in just a couple of points following on from Evelyn Tweed's. I'm interested if you could just give us some idea of how in the future sectoral bargaining might operate within the sector across the public and the third sector and the private sector.
So sectoral bargaining is probably the toughest area to deliver, and there's a lot of work going on in that area. Usually it's fairly straightforward once you define the sector, but even defining the sector has proved difficult in this sphere, and it's very complex. And the way that care operates in Scotland is pretty complex. Generally, there is in sectoral bargaining, there's discussion between a group of employees and an employer or two. There are clearly multiple employers in social care, and then there's also government who have an interest because we provide a lot of the money to pay for commission places and to increase wages. So there's more people around the table than there would normally be in a straightforward case of sectoral bargaining. We are getting into the detail of it now, though. We've approached a couple of academics on the recommendation of some of the trade unions that we work with, and we've involved them to try to help us to unlock these discussions and make progress, and I'm reasonably confident that we will make progress on the area of sectoral bargaining, and I think that absolutely will be crucial to the delivery of fair work in future.
Lovely. Thanks very much. It was very helpful. And also the discussion that you had about engaging the trade unions. And I'm assuming that that you will assure us that you will continue to work with the trade unions as we go through the National Care Service Bill. I'm interested, just my last question, if you don't mind, to what extent and in what ways do you expect the new accord with COSLA on the shared legal accountability in addressing the sort of the concerns of the trade unions and the bill? How do you see that working as we move towards that agreement in the National Care Service?
So you're absolutely right. The trade unions will be crucial to the development of the National Care Service, and I've spent a lot of time over summer working with them, and I would expect that to continue. More than that, I've said a number of times, one of the reasons I think that the social care workforce is so disadvantaged is because it is largely female, 83% female, and barely unionised, so less than 19% unionisation. So I'd like to see a stronger role for unionisation within the workforce, as well as me working with the unions to develop the National Care Service. In terms of the shared agreement, I mean, I talked before about this National Care Board. The National Care Board will be broader than just ministers, local authority representatives and the NHS representatives. I would expect the voice of employees, the voice of people who work in social care, to be at that table as well. So I would envisage an ongoing space at the table for dialogue with them. I think the National Social Work Agency, whilst not a union, it's a professional organisation that we envisage, again, will be a strong voice for social workers in the National Care Service. And I think that social workers are absolutely key to the effective delivery of the ambition that we've set out in this. So I think, again, there will be a strong role for people who work in the sector, not just in the development of the National Care Service, but in the ongoing delivery and national governance of that delivery. As I said, I can't commit to these things yet because we're still discussing it. What I'm laying out today is how I envisage that taking shape.
Thank you, convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. And picking up on that theme of engagement with trade unions, and I declare an interest as a member of Unison, Do you, Minister, envisage that there'll be any changes, any specific changes to the contents of the National Care Service Bill following your ongoing discussions with the trade unions?
Who's best to answer that?
So we are working through...
We're working with them on amendments.
On amendments. I can't recall how many questions we received from the unions, but there were quite a lot, which is totally reasonable. So we've been working through those with them and working through what amendments we might need to make. So we haven't reached any conclusions on that at the moment, but certainly that dialogue is underway.
Okay. Thank you. We're now going to move on to our next theme and pass to Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to your officials. I'm interested in the co-design process and the regional events that took place over the summer, because I know there was, for me, there was an event in Stranraer and there was one in Hoyk, so, and you focus on rural and urban as well. So I'm interested in a little bit more information about the co-design process and whether that was different from other processes that had taken place previously.
So I think generally when you go out to consult, you have a set of proposals on the table. And this has been one of the criticisms of the entirety of this process, is that there isn't enough meat on the bones when we've gone out to speak to people. So usually you have a set of proposals and you say to them, do you like this or do you not like that? And we've taken a step back from that, actually, and we're in a process of co-design. So we spend a great deal of time understanding what the current situation is and trying to imagine a different way of doing things that would absolutely deliver better. So it's a step back, I think, from consultation. It does deliver, what it delivers us is the voice of lived experience right at the heart of the design of the National Care Service. And I think that's really important. I don't envisage that having a hard stop at the end of the bill being delivered. I would envisage the voice of lived experience continuing to be a strong part of how the National Care Service evolves. It's going to help us to get the policy right in the first place, and it's going to help us to deliver it to the ambition that we're given. Is that clear, sufficiently clear for you, or do you want me to bring in officials with a little bit more detail?
Yeah, so I am interested in the fact that, you know, we're taking our step right back to involve people right at the very beginning, because I think that seems to be valuable in involving people with the wide range of experience. So because we've heard of the support that's required right across you know, the social care spectrum, you know, and I probably need to remind everybody that I am a registered nurse, and I spent time over the summer visiting social care delivery people at Stewartry Care in Castle Douglas, and their work is very, very varied and they're very skilled and competent in delivering care for people in their own homes as well. So I am keen to make sure that that people do understand what the co-design process is, because I know that people just assume co-design and co-production is the same thing when it's not. So I suppose, did that come out in any of the consultation process about, you know, this is co-design and it's not co-production?
Yeah, I'm happy to say a wee bit more about that. I think, I mean, as the Minister says, the response from people was fantastic. We had over 500 people at the in-person events, and we had hundreds at the online events too. So absolutely thank you to those people for giving up their time. And I think certainly the people that I spoke to found it a very, very valuable but quite a different process, because we weren't presenting here are some proposals, do you like them or not? It was really getting into the depth of their lived experience and what their understanding of how the system works for them at the moment. So we had the five co-design themes about keeping care support local, information sharing, making sure my voice is heard, realising rights and responsibilities, and valuing the workforce. And I think it's also important to say that when we talk about lived experience, we're talking about the experience of people who work in the sector as well as those who are receiving support or services. And there were, I mean, the reports were published last week, and we can send on the link to those to the committee if that would be a helpful thing to do, convener. And there's some excellent insight in there about how people feel about the way they engage with services. Lots of really helpful information and insight that, as the Minister has said, will help us inform the delivery of the bill, but also the delivery of the National Care Service more broadly. I mean, I could go into lots of detail about this, but I won't, but very happy to answer any further questions.
Mm-hmm. Well, just looking at the government's website, there's lots of information from the six reports and the format that it has. There's accessibility for the format as well. So it's pretty comprehensive, the reports that are here, and probably I'll need to read them in more detail, but I appreciate that. Thank you.
I mean, I guess for me, what the co-design delivers is a sense of empowerment. So it really is about empowering people. It's handing the power over to them to say, okay, if you were in charge, what would you do? How would you do it? How would you design a service? Because we do hear from people time and time again where things go wrong and how, you know, difficult that feels. So it's really about making sure that we get it right from the conception stage rather than just rubbing the edges off delivery. And I have heard from people who are involved that it feels very different. They do say to me, we have been saying these things for years. It's not like we're saying anything new. The difference is that the system, and that includes all of us, are now listening. And I think that's a really important part of the process.
I suppose just a final quick question. It's you talk about empowerment of people. I've heard over the last few years about how people say we want to work with people and do help support their care with them and not do stuff to them. So that's something. Are we making progress on that language as far as working with people rather than doing stuff to them?
Definitely. And I mean, I think the very first time I met the Social Covenant Group, they corrected my language. I made the rookie error of talking about person-centred care, and they said, excuse me, Minister, person-led. So they absolutely want to be in charge, and actually really useful lesson for me early on to listen very carefully to what they are saying and to always make sure that they are in charge and as independent as they can possibly be. That's part of the purpose of designing the bill this way.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And it would be helpful to the committee to receive that additional information from yourself, Ms. Bell, or from the Minister. I'll move to Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks to the panel and the Minister for attending today. I think there has been quite a bit of confusion about what co-design means and how it does differ from consultation. So could you clarify exactly how much influence the learnings from this summer's forum events will have? Are they geared towards how the National Care Service will actually operate in terms of the processes and procedures or the design of individual services within specific areas or in the territorial boards?
Do you want to?
If I can maybe just give an example to help bring co-design to life is probably the work that we've done over the summer under the Realising Rights and Responsibilities design theme, which obviously we know we're committed to a charter of rights and responsibilities for people. We have been taking that draft charter out to individuals in the sessions. They have been helping us design it to make sure that it's meaningful to them, that they feel it has teeth. And that is direct working together designing. And that is a principle that we're also looking to do in the development of the workforce charter as well. So co-design is getting people around the table together, working together to help find the solution, which I think is quite different to the traditional consultation approach.
So just in terms of the framing of the work that we're doing just now, as my colleague has said, areas like the NCS Charter, the Workforce Charter, and I suppose informing the bill and areas like the, in due course, the national board. We're not at the point where we are doing any service design at all. But I think, as Ms Todd has said, as we move forward into the implementation of the National Care Service, there will be a strong expectation that co-design will form part of the future of service design in the National Care Service in Scotland. Does that help, Mr Sweeney?
I think it does, and it has brought us neatly onto that point about the Charter being a critical point of how, you know, it will be the linchpin of how this service will operate and will be its underpinning. There was a bit of dispute previously about having that Charter on the face of the bill. Will that be the opportunity now, given that there has been a draft produced and out to consultation as part of this co-design process? Will Parliament be able to actually have sight of that and codify it, if you like, on the face of the bill, both the NCS Charter and the Workforce Charter? Is that the intent of the government?
I think the expectation is that we should have a form of the draft charter to share with the committee early 2024, so early next year. I think the preference would be, because it is co-design and co-design is very much an ongoing process, and to make sure that we have the ability for that to be iterative and for people to work with us, that it wouldn't be enshrined in the primary legislation, would be the intention. But we definitely would be looking to share a draft with the committee as soon as we think it's an appropriate format.
Okay. At what point does the Charter then become stabilised as a sort of codified document? Like, is that the intent? Like, I know you're saying it's a fluid process, but clearly at some point it's going to have to be finalised and agreed and ratified by all the stakeholders. So at what point do you envisage that actually happening?
So we're currently in the what we call the sense-making phase of the co-design process. So we'll be working through the different phases of that co-design process, and then at a point when we feel that we've reached that agreement as a solid status, we'd look to codify it, as you say, but we'd recognise that it would be a document that we'd want to review regularly and make sure that it's not something that's set aside, because we'll need to make sure that it's meaningful. And that is one of the things about co-design, and is one of the reasons we've enshrined it as a principle within the bill, is that it is an ongoing commitment of the National Care Service through a process of continuous improvement that we would check such things as the Charter.
Could it be an option to have the sort of the initial codified version on the face of the bill, even if it was introduced at stage three, and then with the provisions within the bill that it could be amended through delegated powers in future? At least it gives it a sort of focus within the bill. You know, I know the NHS Charter is very much at the focus of the NHS Acts, that it would be quite nice to have it as a feature in the primary legislation in that sense. Is that something that the government might consider?
We'll certainly consider it. I won't give a promise here today. We'll probably need to discuss that with drafters and get various technical guidance on whether that's a possibility, but we'll certainly consider it and take that away and get back to you about whether that's a possibility or not.
Okay, thanks. And just also on the co-design process, I know there's been a lot of regional events to try and make sure there's geographic coverage, but just also what other methods did you undertake to ensure that as many different stakeholders, particularly underrepresented voices, were given a sufficient opportunity to input to the process?
So I'll come to you in a second. We've, as well as all of the regional events over the summer, we actually, because of popular demand, we added another three regional events since then, and we have a national event at the end of October. We did also hold online events for those people who couldn't attend in person. And we have commissioned some specific work with specific partners to go out and reach those groups that we felt that, you know, when we looked at the information that was coming in, that we felt wasn't, you know, we didn't have 100% coverage. So we've commissioned some specific group, some specific work from specific partners on that front. And Donna, I'll give you a little bit.
I was just going to mention the work that we've done to follow up with those seldom heard voices, because we do want to make sure that we maximise the reach of this work, and we'll continue to do that as we go along if we review the evidence that we're seeing coming back from the co-design process and seeing that there are groups that are either underrepresented or not represented at all. We are proactively seeking input from people, and quite a lot of the time doing that through colleagues in the third sector is a really good way to do that. So we've provided grants to a few organisations to provide some supported engagement with the co-design process.
That's very helpful. Thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. I'm going to stay with you to lead on the next theme. Oh, you're on mute. Mr. Sweeney, you're on mute.
Sorry, I don't have control of my mute button, unfortunately, so apologies for that. We are just moving on to proposals for delivery of services, and we know that there's a postcode lottery of access to social care services. Within the new structure of the National Care Service, how do the Scottish Government plan to improve access?
So that will be crucial to the success of the delivery, actually, is how we improve access. We're aware at the moment, I mean, we all pore over, and particularly coming into winter, the figures around delayed discharge, and we are less good at capturing, but equally important is the level of unmet need that we know is in the community for people seeking care packages who've been assessed and aren't able to get them. So we know that accessibility at every step is a challenge. One of the challenges that we face is that there are different levels of integration around the country. As I said, that level that makes it difficult to know where services are falling between different, you know, so sometimes what we think is happening is that services are falling between the cracks in terms of accountability between different models of design. We are absolutely determined to, I see the National Care Service as the natural next step in integration. So this is about further integration. We see around the country different models of integration. In some parts of the country, mental health is included. In other parts of the country, it isn't. And as I say, I think that gives rise to some of the postcode lottery and some of the challenge in taking steps to improve accessibility. So I think we'll be looking at whether that serves the nation well, and probably... The thing is to improve integration in every part of the country. The National Social Work Agency will bring forward national standards, and I think that will be an important part about improving delivery and making sure that everywhere operates to the same national standard. It will give protection, I think, to individual social workers so that they know what they need to do at each step of the way in their jobs, and I think that's really important. That national board, as I said, I mean, I'm pretty determined it's going to have teeth, so it won't just be there for decoration. It will absolutely be there to take an overview and take action if there is service delivery failure in any part of the country. So where problems arise, that national care board will be able to take action to correct any problems. And of course, one of the things that I think will be really important, and we've spoken about it, I think last time I was at committee as well, there is just reported a review on independent inspection and scrutiny. I think that is providing us with, and we've still to reflect and respond to that as a government, but I think that will provide us with another lever to pull to improve the situation and to improve the standards nationally. I think that it is a really important part of the process, getting that inspection and scrutiny process right. And I suppose one of the aims is to shift from what's perceived as a punitive system, where people are where there is reputational damage if things are falling short, to a more supportive system where there is a ethos of continuous improvement and where support is available easily to try to improve standards where they are found to fall short.
I think that point about continuous improvement and benchmarking and sort of bringing everyone up to highest common denominator is a helpful insight to the sort of aspirations of the government in this respect. But there is an issue that was brought up in discussion with the Cabinet Secretary when the TOLC committee earlier this month, that scrapping residential and non-residential care charges by 2026 wasn't necessarily going to be achievable anymore, and it certainly wasn't going to be a key priority going forward. How does the government propose to address that postcode lottery without scrapping non-residential care charges? And is this something that is being considered within the development of the National Care Service?
So as far as I know, that commitment still stands. It remains. We are in exceptionally difficult fiscal times at the moment. You know, I don't think there's ever been a more challenging time to be in government in terms of finding the money to deliver the commitments that we have made. But I'm kind of operating on a precedental apprehended basis, so nobody has told me that we're not doing that. We are, as far as I am concerned, definitely doing it.
Okay, well, that's reassuring. Thanks very much.
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. Move to Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. You have touched on some of this already, but I'm just wondering if you can say what it is the Scottish Government is doing to support local authorities and health and social care partnerships with the current and immediate issues in social care and support provision, so, for example, staffing and capacity.
So there's a lot of work. Obviously, the delivery of the £12 an hour, I think, is key. I think that is going to help, but it's not everything. So there's work going on across the board to improve, as well as pay conditions, focusing initially on maternity leave and sick pay. So that's one of the Fair Work strands. There's work going on with the SSSC and NEST to try to provide both educational opportunities to support the workforce so that when people come into the social care workforce, they feel well supported, they know what it is they need to do, and they have clear pathways to improve and clear pathways to further careers should they wish to study and move on. There is, as I say, a great deal of work going on across the board, and not all of it requires primary legislation for it to happen. I think that some of it we can deliver without the primary legislation. I do think a transformative change is required if we're to achieve one of the things I hope we will achieve is an increase in the status of social care. So I would love it if in Scotland we were talking not just about social care as something that helps the NHS when it's in trouble or harms the NHS when it's not functioning right, but valued it in its own right, in its inherent ability to change people's lives. So social care changes, totally transforms the lives of those people who are able to access it. It transforms their family lives. You know, I meet again day in, day out carers who are stretched to the limit trying to cope with the situations that they're in. An effective social care system takes the burden off families. It contributes to communities and it contributes to the economy. And we're quite keen to try to start talking. We talk a lot about the cost of social care. We don't talk quite so much about the value of social care. I'm determined to move the conversation on to the value, because again, you know, I on a very regular basis, I meet people who are struggling to work because of their caring responsibilities. If we get social care working right, it will have an impact on the economy. And if we can articulate that better, then we'll stop thinking quite so much about the cost and start recognising the value, which is what we do with the NHS.
I think you're absolutely right there, and it's certainly something I'm sure we can all agree on how valuable it is, and those pathways that you spoke about are just so important too. I'd like to ask you about the end of life, because not everyone will recover. And a substantial proportion of the current health and social care budgets is spent on caring for people approaching the end of life. At a previous committee, we had Mark Hazelwood, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Partnership for Palliative Care, calling for changes to the principles of the bill to include end-of-life care. So I guess my question really is, how will the National Care Service be developed to respond to the growing needs for palliative and end-of-life care? And also, how are co-design forums informing this?
So, I don't know if Donna would... Probably you can give more detail, I would have to say. I haven't been asked very much about palliative care, although the reality is that when people... The vast majority of people who go into a care home go into the care home at the end of their lives and will pass away within around an 18-month period. So it's there, but it's not up front. But I'll let Donna talk a little bit more.
You know, year as well, the amount of hospital admissions, etc., there as well, that we're always talking about taking down admissions, but obviously that's something that's not quite so movable.
Absolutely. So I'm really keen. I mean, I'm absolutely determined, particularly because of where I live. So the geography where I live is very, very challenging for social care. We don't have a care home in the village that I live in. If you are unable to manage independently in your home in my village, you're going to have to move away from your community, from your family, to access care, probably on the other coast. That's the reality for people in the Highlands. So one of the reasons for our focus in the National Care Service to absolutely shift care upstream and try to get into that early intervention and prevention end of things to support people to live independently and healthily at home for as long as possible before care is needed is about enabling people to grow old and frail and potentially die in their own communities. We are determined to deliver that. I'll pass over to Donna for a bit more detail on palliative care.
Yeah, and we have engaged very broadly through the co-design process, particularly with people who have looked after relatives who have received palliative care. What we have avoided doing is naming multiple conditions or multiple situations on the face of the bill, because there are many, many circumstances that people will find themselves in. I think the importance of the charter is crucial here. So the aspects around dignity, respect, equalities are all going to be critical, particularly in the case of palliative care. So I think what we would want to do is ensure that the aspects of the charter that we want to draw out can be applied across all aspects of people's care, not just specific to palliative care, but certainly they would have a clear role in ensuring people do have the dignity and the care that they need as they go through the palliative process. So hopefully that answers your question just in terms of the face of the bill. And there are other mechanisms to draw all of that in. But again, very happy to look at that and to pick up again with Mark on palliative care.
So can I just ask, are you finding that you're actually getting that feedback to help inform it through the National Care Service forums, or is there more work to be done in that area?
There's always going to be more work to be done. I think we are getting some really good feedback, particularly on the charter, about how those rights can be made to feel real, how they're very clear. One of the key things was make sure that it is unambiguous and that people can really see what their rights are, how they can hold partners and the accountable bodies to account for those rights. So I think we are getting that feedback. But again, you know, that, as the Minister's already said, we'll continue to do that engagement. And we have not just the individual lived experience panel of experts, but we do have the stakeholder register, which has over 300 organisations included in that. So, yeah, very happy to pick that up again.
Great, thank you. Tisbite.
Thank you, Convener. This section is the current status of social care. So, good morning, Minister. Good morning, Directors. Mm-hmm. The National Care Service will cost upwards of £1.3 billion pounds and is already overdue. So you've said this morning, Minister, that there's a great deal of work going on, but you also said that you currently have no control over social care. So my question is, what are you able to do in the interim period to support the social care provision that's going on right now? Thank you.
So one thing that we're doing is putting a lot of extra money in. We made a commitment during this term of Parliament to increase the amount that we spend on social care by a quarter. That would be £840 million going into social care. And we're already, I think, at 800, so we're ahead of trajectory on that. So we are vastly increasing the amount of money that we put into social care. I think Derek Feely was very clear, and I hear, you know, if I think what you're asking is correct, it's, you know, what should we be pursuing structural change at a time when the system is under so much pressure? And Derek Feely was very, very clear that if we just keep doing the same thing again and again and again, we will just keep getting the same outcome. And we are very clear that the system is not working as we would want it for those people who are accessing care at the moment. So we need that systematic, you know, we need that whole system change. We need a transformational change to be delivered in order to meet the aspirations of the nation, frankly.
Minister, the question is, what are you doing now? So that £840 million, which is great that that's being spent on it, what's that going on?
So things like increased wages, that would be one thing that we've done. So we've drastically increased the amount of money that people working in social care get paid. I think over the last couple of years, it's over 14% wage rise that they've had. So that's one clear thing that is improvement that will be felt by everyone working in social care. People working in social care in Scotland are now paid more than their counterparts all over the UK. There's more to be done, but I think that sets us on a clear path, and that's what I would expect to do more of that.
So that pay, you're saying that £840 million, that's going in the public sector and the private sector
pay
increases?
Yes, because we have a mixed market.
Thank you. So the second question, Minister, is Shona Robison pledged to end delayed discharge in 2015. The question is, why, after such a long time, has social care sector not been given the resources to end bed blocking in the NHS? Thank you.
So it is a complex, you know, it's a tricky challenge to fix. If it were easily fixable, we'd have certainly done it by now. There's lots of work going on across the system all last winter, and, you know, as soon as the winter was over, reflection began on how to rise and face the challenges that we would expect to meet this winter again. It's not, the situation that Scotland is in is not unique, so this is pretty similar all over the UK, and it's pretty similar in many developed countries. There are a number of challenges. I mean, we were undoubtedly, as your question alludes, we were undoubtedly not rising to the challenge of delayed discharge prior to the pandemic, but we're in a really difficult situation now because of the pandemic. So we've seen sustained pressure over the whole of our health and social care system for a number of years now, and that's one of the reasons we're in such a difficult situation with delayed discharges. We have, of course, got a whole new condition that is being coped with. There will be several hundred people in hospital today with COVID and COVID-related complications. So there's a whole extra condition to be coped with, as well as the fact that the staff and the systems have been experiencing sustained pressure for the last 3 years during the course of the pandemic. What are we going to do to improve it? Well, we have a lot, and I suppose that's the crux of the issue. How are we going to move forward from where we are now? We have a lot of work going on across the system, a lot of collaboration with local governance systems. We're producing dashboards of data, so we're spent some time over the course of the last few months improving the data that we can provide both to ministers and to local governance structures to try to ensure that there is quick action taken where problems are brewing. There's a suite of things that we know work, so things like discharge before 12. There are programmes in place like Home First, which, you know, that's a really interesting programme, and you know, the early results are really impressive, so we probably need to at pace ensure that that programme increases and is delivered at a high level right across the country. That's a programme which, instead of awaiting an assessment in a hospital, if you're an inpatient in a hospital, instead of waiting for an assessment in a hospital environment, you're discharged to home and assessed at home. And what they are finding very clearly is that a smaller package is required to support people at home if they are discharged quickly with support immediately. So obviously that's something we're striving to get spread all over the country. There's lots of work to be done, but there is no magic pill, and if there was, we would do it, and everyone else, every other country in the UK would be doing it too.
Thank you. So it sounds like you're doing a lot of work on delayed discharge.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And I'm going to move to Sandesh Kulhani, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, and I just want to declare my interest as a practicing NHS GP. Since the decision from the Scottish Government to go back out to consultation, what's been the cost to the taxpayer for the NCS bill to tread water?
So I would challenge that narrative. We're not treading water. This is the second time I've been in front of this committee to explain exactly the level of work that's going on across the country. So we paused and have worked very hard with partners, local government, and with trade unions and with people with lived experience to try to find a way forward. You'll be aware that we were pretty much in a situation where we couldn't move forward because the level of opposition to the bill was so great. So I'm really pleased that we have achieved consensus and we are now moving forward. I think we provided the Finance Committee with costs for the bill so far last week. So I guess if you check the papers from the Finance Committee from last week, you'll be able to see set out exactly how much spending there has been on the bill at each stage of the way so far.
So what is that number, Minister?
Sorry, could you say that again?
What is that number?
So I don't have the numbers in front of me at the moment, but it's significantly less than was predicted because the pace of delivery is slower. So the slowing of the pace, the pausing and the phasing of the introduction of the National Care Service means that it's costing less. I don't know if you've got the table in front of you.
I don't have the table in front of me, and I think we probably also need to make the distinction between work that would have been underway anyway. So we always plan to do the work on the summer of co-design. The bill has been, or certainly stage one, will now take place before the 31st of January. So it's quite a difficult judgment to make in terms of whether there has been a cost to delay or whether there hasn't, because the work that we had planned has just been rescheduled. And as Ms Todd says, certainly we provided information on the costs to develop the bill and the programme of activity. The bill is actually one part of the work. There are various engagement activities that are underway. There are also policy development and broader activities that are underway too. So we can certainly provide to the committee the information that we provided to the Finance Committee on spend to date on the bill, if that would be helpful, Convener.
Yes, I think that would be helpful.
Sorry.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. So let me get this straight, right? So the government created a bill, and you said to me, Minister, that the significant opposition to the bill that the Conservatives brought up and discussed many times, and the government said they were just going to press ahead. And it's now, because of that opposition to the bill, you stopped to reconsider, but you don't think that's treading water? and you don't have figures to tell me what the cost was. If I say it was £15.4 million, would that be accurate?
I'm so really sorry, I didn't hear that figure. Could you repeat that figure, please?
£15.4 million.
I don't recognise that.
No, we don't recognise that figure. So I didn't say that the Conservatives slowed the delivery of the bill. I mean, the Conservatives were one group that were opposed to the bill as introduced, but there was significant opposition to the bill as introduced. I think it's reasonable in the face of significant opposition that the government takes a pause and works with the people who are concerned about the direction of travel, on the direction of travel, and that's what we've done. The bill will be delivered. I mean, we'll finish stage one by the end of January next year. Of course, it's down to Parliament how fast it progresses through Parliament, but I would expect there to be significant progress in the next few months.
OK, thank you, Minister.
Thank you. And Emma Harper.
Just to go back to what I would recommend people do is look at the government's website, because there's so much comprehensive information about the National Care Service, all the reports, all the engagements over summer, the work that's been done to connect locally. And I think it's great that Stranraer was one of the places, you know, because the folk from Stranraer always feel forgotten. So, I mean, how would you think it would be, I suppose, how do the government get the message out for people to look at what's on the government website to show the power of work that's been done over the summer? What's the best way to share that information?
So, yeah, good question. There is a lot of work and a lot of evidence there. I mean, perhaps there's almost too much, and people are finding it hard to navigate the volume of information that is out there. We can certainly reflect on how to communicate. We have specific forums where we meet and hear from and talk to people with lived experience. We also have ongoing engagement with trade unions, which has been really vital to improve communication. There have been a number of When I first came into post, there was a number of people concerned about things that just weren't correct, and actually correcting those myths has been an important part of the work done during the course of the pause. We do have a social media programme, which is a really rich bringing to life of, you know, so it can be tough, I guess, for what we all love reading, and we read a lot for our work, but it can be tough for Joe Bloggs out there to read through pages and pages of information in somewhat dense text. So there's Voices of Care videos that kind of bring to life different aspects that we're working on, which I would definitely commend to people to have a look at. It really brings what we're trying to achieve to life.
My question isn't a criticism, it's just that there is comprehensive information out there, and
Absolutely.
There's easy read documents as well for people, and if you're referring to videos as well, that's another great way for folk to watch videos on their phone or whatever. So yeah, my point is that there's a lot of work that's been done over the summer, and it would be good for people to be able to see that.
Absolutely. Yeah, we'll certainly reflect more on how we can make sure that we highlight that to folk. You're absolutely right. There is a lot of detail out there.
And just for clarity, Minister or your officials, the figures that Sandesh Gulhani was asking for were made available to the Finance Committee. So those figures are published.
And certainly we can provide them to the committee if that would be a helpful thing to do.
I think that would be very helpful. Thank you. I'm now going to move to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. With the pause on the National Care Service, some unpaid carers are concerned about the delay that may mean to the right to breaks from caring coming into place. Could you update us, Minister, on what work is being done to progress this area while the bill is still being worked on?
So you're absolutely right. It's really crucial that carers have a life alongside caring. And I mentioned already, I do meet, you know, I meet so regularly with so many people involved in social care and people who are caring for members of their family are very often at the end of their tether. That's one of the reasons why I'm absolutely passionate about getting care in, shifted higher upstream towards early intervention and prevention so that people don't get to crisis point before help is available to them. It's absolutely crucial that carers have their own life alongside caring and that they're able to sustain their own health and well-being. So we are doing a lot of work within the bill, as you're well aware, to kind of enshrine that right to breaks, but we're acting now to expand easy access to short breaks support ahead of the legislation, so we're not waiting for the legislation to make that change. We've increased the voluntary sector short breaks fund by 5 million to 8 million and we've maintained it at 8 million for 23-24. And that's in addition to the Carers Act funding, the 88.4 million that goes through in the local government block grant. So we are, you know, trying hard to support carers before making their right to a break, before putting it on the face of the bill.
And the money is hugely welcome, and I'm sure we would all welcome that. One of the other concerns that has been raised in particular with me is geographical variation in those easy access, as you're well aware, Minister, being a rural constituency MSP, that geographic variation, but also the variation in the support that's available. Not everyone wants what I'm sure many people, many of the general public would see traditional short breaks as. Many people want to be able to take their loved one with them on holiday and be supported in that way as well. So in terms of both geographic variation and the diversity of short break offering, what specific work is going on in those two areas to make sure that we're ahead of the game by the time the bill comes into force?
So I think this probably points to, an issue, and I keep saying one size does not fit all. So one of the things that we are trying to do with this legislation generally is make it more person-centred, person-led, if I correct my own language, as per social covenant group guidance. So we want it to be flexible and we want it to work for the people who are needing that support. So we are going to need to work really hard on the ground to ensure that there is a person-led approach to this carer support. One of the things that I've been asked about before is things like defining sufficient breaks. And we could toil and come to an agreement on what the definition of that is, but actually more importantly it is whether the person who is accessing that support feels that they have had sufficient breaks. So I think, you know, as in all things, we need to build something that is flexible, that's person-centred, person-led, and that delivers the difference that we are hoping to see, and that will be tough, I think. As you say, at the moment we've got a variety of options across the country, some easier to access than others, some more enticing than others, and we are already working pretty hard right across the board to try to improve that situation. I don't know if either of you want to say anything.
So it's just to build upon what the Minister said, is that we're, as part of our co-design, but also with our stakeholder engagement, we're working with a stakeholder working group on this very issue to have them help us define what those sufficient breaks would look like and mean to them. And I know that those groups include representatives from island and rural communities, so that is a very live issue that we have been discussing with them, and it's really important that they have their voices heard to help us work that through. I was just in a conversation last week about the reality of what a sufficient break means to a carer, and this is where the voice of those unpaid carers in the room is really important, and also the local carer centres who understand their communities and their community needs. So we're very committed to working with them to help us develop those regulations and guidance to make sure that we truly are delivering it as consistently as possible across the country.
That's great. Thanks, Kamina.
Thank you. And I'm going to move to Tess White, who has a brief
follow-up. Thank you, Kamina. Minister, you recently told social care providers in Shetland. It's not our intention to come up here and tell you how to do things. How will the independence of local providers be respected when you're centralising social care across Scotland? Thank you.
So, again, I would challenge that narrative. We're not centralising social care across Scotland. I was very clear when I went to Shetland, actually. They had... we were really impressed by the level of integration that they were achieving and the work that was going on between the NHS and the local authority to ensure that there was a cohesive package of social care available everyone. And I joke with them, maybe what we'll do is pick up the Shetland way and roll that out over Scotland rather than us coming and imposing the Edinburgh way on Shetland. We'll take the Shetland way all over Scotland. I think, though, that even in that room at that time, we could recognise things that were... So Shetland were doing excellently, but there were things that they needed national support with. And that's where we want to make the difference. So, for example, in terms of information sharing, that requires a little bit of primary legislation in order to make that easier. And, you know, again, when you engage with people with lived experience, they are tired of telling their story again and again and again to everyone that they meet within the system. That ability to share information safely and appropriately within the system needs to be unlocked centrally by central government, and we can do that, and that will enable better local delivery. There are things that we can do to help in terms of, you know, one of the things we talked about was the challenge of recruiting social workers, so professionals in Shetland. There are definitely things that we can do to support them with that nationally, to make it easier to recruit, to make it easier to train, to take away some of the barriers to entry to training that there are in place in places like Shetland. So again, I'm keen to hear what the challenges are in every local area and see what we can do nationally to unlock them. I am not interested in micromanaging the entirety of social care from Edinburgh all over the country. And I've said time and time again, I mean, I live in the rural West Highlands. Social care in Ullapo, where I live, looks very different to social care in Inverness. Both of those are within NHS Highland. So even within local authorities, if they are to be responsive to the needs of their community, the geography and the situations that they face in terms of labour shortages, they are going to have to be flexible in how they deliver it. And we're keen to create a system that supports and empowers that whilst maintaining national standards, so that there is a clear expectation that wherever you are in the country, this is the standard, this is the quality you can expect to access. But it might look a little bit different depending on where you access it.
Thank you. Can I thank the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport for attending today, and to her officials also for the information they've provided. And we are going to briefly suspend while we change panels. Thank you. The third item on our agenda is a further session as part of the committee's pre-budget scrutiny for 2024-25. And for this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Richard McCallum, Director of Health Finance and Governance, Stephen Lee Ross, Deputy Director of Health Workforce Planning and Development, and Niamh O'Connor, Deputy Director of Directorate of Population Health, Scottish Government. And we're going to move straight to questions. And I'm going first to Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. And I think my questions are probably for you, Richard, but if anybody else wants to come in, please do. Richard, are financial pressures evenly spread? Might areas that are geographically remote or more deprived experience these issues more acutely? And if so, how can this be mitigated against?
Yeah. So I think the first thing to say, and thanks, Convener, for the invitation to speak this morning, and I think we appreciate the chance to come along and actually the evidence that we've heard and some of the submissions that have come in from other areas have been really useful in helping inform our own budget considerations as we work forward. And I know we'll get the report from the committee as well in due course, so that's much appreciated. And I know actually on some of your specific points, Ms. Tweed, in terms of the rurality factors that impact on the cost of services, that has something that's come through in some of the evidence sessions from the likes of NHS Borders and others as well. I mean, I think probably three things I would want to highlight. I mean, I think there are a number of, we know that there are financial pressures across the whole system. And whether you're in a very urban or rural health board area, or indeed in a more remote or rural area, some of those things are being felt across the system. We know we're seeing increases in inflation, and that will affect all boards. So I think just to note that particular point. I mean, I think secondly, though, you are right, and I think there are particular challenges that there can be for remote and rural boards in particular. We know that there's been some challenges, particularly around recruitment and retention, and that can drive additional costs as well. I think the third thing I'd say is, well, what are we doing about it? And, you know, a couple of specific points on that. One, I mean, we've talked before at this committee about the NRAC formula, and actually that is the key and main driver of funding for health boards in Scotland. And one of the factors that the NRAC formula takes into account is, as well as age, deprivation, and a number of other factors, is remote and rural. And it will take into account some of the factors that might drive increased costs. So when we're allocating to health boards, we're actively taking account of the NRAC formula. But I would also say as well, we are trying to do specific actions as well as that, and specific investment on top of that as well. So in primary care, for example, we're doing the remote and rural healthcare work at the moment through NES, and £3 million is going to be invested over the course of the next year to support that work, and that will help promote and support retention of services in remote and rural areas.
Thanks for that answer. How are the short-term needs and long-term needs being balanced? We heard a lot about both in evidence, but especially in terms of preventative spend.
Well, I'll maybe bring in Niamh in just a second in terms of some specific examples. And I think the answer is we have to do both, and the two aren't separate either. So we know that we have some very acute and specific needs at the moment in terms of the backlog of people waiting for services. And it's absolutely right and important that as we come into those budget considerations, appropriate investment is given to support our health boards as they tackle those backlogs. But equally, we know that that actually the longer term, as you say, realities is we need to actually get upstream and make sure that we're actually closing off at the source some of the pressures that we're seeing in our acute hospitals at the moment. So whether that's in relation to the work that's been done in relation to multidisciplinary teams in a number of boards, we've seen a big increase in that, looking to actually drive more support and care for people in the community. And indeed, there's a whole lot more we do in terms of the wider investment, whether it's minimum unit pricing or things in the alcohol space, which are actually trying to support that very early prevention. But I'll maybe bring in Niamh to give some more specifics in terms of actions.
Thank you, Richard. And the committee member is absolutely right. I know in some of the written submissions that the committee has received, there's been from Public Health Scotland or from Health and Social Care Partnerships, there's been reference, and from IPPR, and there was evidence at the last committee session on this, evidence around the Scottish burden of disease. And if we just look at demographics alone, then looking ahead to 2043, that forecasts 21% increase in the disease burden. I think the important thing to note from that work is that that's without any impact of prevention or any impact of innovation. So that's just looking at demographics. And it means that, and often they go together, that prevention and innovation, that without that sort of really embedded at the heart of the long-term reform efforts, both population health and health and care system reform efforts, we would really struggle to make the progress that we need to make. So one of the kind of vehicles, the care and wellbeing approach, as Audit Scotland mentioned in their submission, spoke really about being clear about what we mean about prevention and preventative spend. It's an often used word and can mean different things in different parts of the system. So we worked with Public Health Scotland about 12 months ago now, and in January there was a publication there on really clarity on what we mean by the public health approach to prevention and the role of NHS Scotland in that instance. But there's obviously much, much wider role for other budgets too. And that really clarifies three big components of what we mean by prevention. So primary prevention, stopping those health problems from arising in the very first place. So secondary vaccination, a classic example of that, and the budgets around that key. Secondary prevention, that finding health problems early and intervening to stop them worsening, better outcomes for people, screening a good example there. And then tertiary prevention, really managing established health problems as well as possible, ideally close to home, in order to minimise harms. And that clarity of that definition system-wide, whole system-wide, has been really important. And we've been, working then, so we have that national clarity and national cross-government work on some of those wider determinants of health, those big building blocks. And I know the committee will be fully aware that it's the budgets outside the health and social care budget and the pre-budget scrutiny that you'll also be very much alert to in terms of their impact on poverty, on housing, on the things that we know drive health outcomes. But there's also local examples of that prevention and action and that primary space. So a lot of work around NHS Scotland really becoming proper anchor institutions with their huge footprint, their ability to employ large people locally, and use of land and assets. So there's examples around anchors and also around service design and service change that's happening in that tertiary space. So shifting the balance of care, very happy to give a specific example of that if members would like to hear that. Community glaucoma this year is one, so happy to say a little about that.
Thank you very much.
Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. Richard, you just spoke about the minimum unit pricing. Can you tell me exactly what benefit we've seen with that, please?
Yeah, so obviously that's work that's still ongoing, and there's further discussion about that in the coming months ahead. But Public Health Scotland published a report at the end of June, and it highlighted that minimum unit pricing as it is in its current form had reduced alcohol sales by 3%, that deaths caused directly by alcohol had reduced by 13.4%, and that hospital admissions had decreased by 4.1%. So, you know, this is something that, work and studies are ongoing, but Public Health Scotland have put those, you know, they can't be specific, but the estimates that they've put in suggest that that's an impact and a direct impact of the minimum unit pricing that we've had in place.
Thank you for that, because a bit confused, because what you've just quoted for hospitalisations is not a significant figure. So what you've just quoted there is an insignificant number, so that can't be right. You talked about the deaths reduction. That's not an accurate figure either, is it? Because it's actually it's a potential reduction in an increase in rate versus England, and dependent drinkers have been shown to continue to be drinking. So could you just explain to me how you have got that and said that on the record?
Okay, well, I'll maybe bring in Niamh O'Connor, who's worked closely with Public Health Scotland, who've produced the report that that I was quoting from. So I'll bring in Niamh at this point.
Thank you, Richard, and thank you very much, Dr. Gulhani. And the evaluation that Richard just mentioned, and I know you've had concerns about that in the public domain already, so aware of that. I think the key thing around that is, like all studies based on a robust evidence base or surveys or thing, you know, we can think about things like GDP or inflation figures. The key thing there is that they are estimates, but that there is a real transparency of the robustness around which those estimates have been derived. So the Public Health Scotland evaluation of MUP had a really robust governance process around the evaluation. The details for that are in the public domain. And there is, you know, expert opinion from people like Professor Sir Michael Marmot, Professor Peter Rice, who've written a letter in The Lancet that was published recently, really expressing confidence in the robustness of the approach, the robustness of the methodology. But I know the member has made very important points about clarity of communication around when things are estimates from studies and making sure that those are transferred into all products that try and explain the results of in-depth evaluations. And they're very valid points around use of, for example, the word estimate, so that it's clear in products like very brief evaluation findings or news releases, for example, that kind of nuance carries through into products like that, and that's a very important point. I think probably the point going back to things like, for example, the UK Stats Authority, is their fundamental point about the findings in that final PHS report have been communicated clearly and impartially, and I think there is confidence in the robustness of that evaluation.
Thank you. I'm going to move to Emma Harper for a supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Just a quick supplementary. Minimum unit pricing was introduced. We've also had a pandemic, and we've heard that during the pandemic, during lockdown, that there was changes in the people's consumption of alcohol. So some folk that drank a lot drank even more, and some folk that drank less even drank less. So what would be your thoughts on how the pandemic has affected alcohol consumption, and has that skewed any of the minimum unit pricing information that has been brought forward?
Happy to come in on that, if that's okay, Richard. So certainly, as the impact of the pandemic is understood more by global experts on alcohol consumption globally, there's a growing consensus that it did impact on population-level drinking behaviours, especially amongst the harmful and hazardous category of drinkers, where there was increased consumption, and we see really noticeable double-digit increases in alcohol mortality in places like the US, in Canada, and in other parts of the UK. And there's a kind of growing global consensus that that is related to the pandemic. So the importance of the evaluation that we've just spoken about is those findings around deaths averted are kind of in a, done in a control case around what would have happened if MUP hadn't been in place. And so the findings of the evaluation were, given that global pattern of impact of the pandemic on population level drinking behaviours without minimum unit pricing, it's plausible that this mortality would have been much worse in Scotland. I'm aware too, and if the committee member is comfortable, I didn't pick up the previous committee member's point on dependent drinkers, which is an important one. I don't know if the committee member is happy if I cover that briefly now.
Yeah, I am. Mm-hmm.
So the very important point on dependent drinkers is that's a kind of small subset. Estimates vary, but potentially around 1% of the population who are at that kind of extreme end of harmful and hazardous drinkers with clinical addiction needs that need clinical support. And so, and I know a number of members of the committee were part of the cross-party work with the NCD Alliance on that recently published report, but there's a critical point there about packages of measures always being necessary for complex social outcomes. There's never a silver bullet in any one of these, and that's exactly the case for alcohol harm. So prevention is in that primary, secondary, tertiary. It's a kind of spectrum, and so there's a range of measures around alcohol pre-interventions, UK clinical guidance getting updated, the investment going through ADPs to really support improvements in treatment for those suffering from alcohol dependency and addiction. But it's a very important point that the committee makes well.
Mm-hmm. We now have a minister that has a combined portfolio of drugs and alcohol, and again, minimum unit pricing isn't the only action that is being taken forward as a public health approach. And you mentioned the Non-Communicable Disease Alliance, which I was part of that report that was created by them regarding our NCDs.
Thank you. Thanks. I'm now going to move to Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. This is a nuts and bolts question first. So, Mr McCallum, how is the allocation of social care agreed within the overall health and social care budget? Thank you.
Yeah, so, I mean, this is something that, you know, we have conversations not just within health, but within local government and with conversations with COSLA, and that's as part of the discussion that we'll be having in the coming weeks and months as we move up to the budget period. So this is something that we would take forward in conjunction with wider Scottish Government colleagues, but as I say, with external stakeholders, particularly COSLA as well. I mean, I think the key thing that we'll be particularly considering is the commitments that have been made and shaped around both the policy prospectus and indeed the programme for government. So as you'll be aware, one of the key commitments is around the increase in adult commission services for social care to £12 an hour, and that will be one consideration that we will be taking into account and being considered. The other factor I think that we will be playing through and will be considering as part of the budget process is that overall allocation to health boards, and health boards do allocate on a further element to integration authorities as well, and integration authorities have that overall budget responsibility across a range of health and social care services, and so some of the consideration will be in that space as well of the allocation of funds to ultimately to IJBs.
Okay, so different stakeholders pulling in the data. So my second question relates to, we had a previous committee session where Philip White of the Institute for Public Policy Research said, when it comes to staff, funding, resources and everything else, the balance of where we deliver care is still very much stuck in the secondary first model, rather than starting to look at what we can do to bolster the role of primary care. So the question is this a fair assessment in your opinion, and has primary care been given the funding it needs?
So I think this is a point that has been considered, and again probably has been considered by this committee, I think, for some time. And we've talked about that shift in the balance of spend from sort of secondary acute care over to community primary care, and a commitment from Scottish Government ministers to see that shift beyond 50% over the lifetime of this Parliament. We're actually at a point where we're just short of that. We're about 49.2%, I think, in that position. And I think one of the key considerations as part of this budget and in budgets in future years will be in relation to making that shift happen. So at a very sort of strategic level, I would say that there's that kind of there's that key focus, if you like, of moving spend. I think in relation to primary care, again, key commitment from ministers around that increase in primary care funding. So if I take something like the Primary Care Improvement Fund as an example, we've seen that grow from 155 million a couple of years ago to 170 million a year ago to 190 million in the current financial year. And I guess, again, one of the key considerations for us, because I think it is a fair challenge back and a fair challenge about primary care, is to see that increase further. And we know that there's really good evidence already coming through for the work we're doing in relation to multidisciplinary teams, to community link workers, that's having a real impact. And that's something that certainly is part of the budget consideration, and indeed I think some of the evidence that you've already received that will be a big part of our considerations. I'm not sure if either of my colleagues want to come in and say any more on that point.
I'm happy to come in with a very specific example, if the member would find that useful. So sometimes we can talk about shifting the balance of care in quite an abstract way, but I mentioned the community glaucoma service in that example of tertiary prevention, so managing a condition as well as possible, ideally close to home. And that's a service that after, you know, a good number of years' work with community optometry, with the ophthalmology profession, with patients receiving the service, has now been rolled out. NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde first sending letters out to patients. And the service discharges, where clinically appropriate, patients with glaucoma to management in the community, so from the hospitalised service. And this care closer to home, it's a kind of concrete example of shifting that balance of care with appropriate work happening with our national boards, including NES, on the kind of workforce developments required for that. And at its full rollout, that service should be able to see up to 20,000 patients. NHS Lanarkshire is next in November in terms of rollout. And we know ophthalmology is often one of the top busiest outpatient specialties. So we can see specific examples of that shifting the balance of care happening that Philip White, that you mentioned, referred to in his advice, in his evidence.
It all sounds really good, but the question is, in terms of last year, the Scottish Government cut £65 million from the primary care budget. That's £65 million. It's a huge amount of money. So how is primary care meant to cope with increasing demands when services are being cut like this?
Yeah, so a couple of things on that. And I think you're referring to the emergency budget revision that happened in November last year. Specifically, that budget decision was taken in the context of a very, you know, challenging financial settlement generally across the Scottish Government, and actually all portfolios were looking at the financial challenge that was faced. I think what I would say is that was a non-recurring reduction. So, you know, it's not that is continued indefinitely. So whilst there was that pressure was recognised as part of the 22-23 financial position, that isn't £65 million that has gone recurringly from primary care. I think it was recognising as well that as we've built up additional funding in primary care over a number of years, actually that some of the money that's been allocated, I mentioned IJBs, is in IJB reserves. And so rather than allocating additional funding to support things like the Primary Care Improvement Fund, there was an expectation that the integration authorities would use their reserves in the first instance before that additional funding was allocated. So That was the decision around that 65 million. As I say, that's not something that's rolled forward into the current financial year. And we know, as you say, that primary care is incredibly important as we move forward. And so that will be something, as I say, that we'll consider as part of the 24-25 budget as well.
Thank you.
Steve, do you want to come in? Sorry.
I'm fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. Many submissions to the committee highlighted the difficulty of engaging in forward planning and prevention while relying on single-year funding settlements, which may be linked to evidence of performance in the short term. Can the panel advise how the government is working with health boards to support them to engage in long-term financial planning? And how likely is it that we can move to a system of multi-year budgeting, in your opinion, given that many of the Scottish Government's budgetary decisions are reliant on those of the UK Government?
I think it's a fair challenge, and I know that a number of boards and others have raised this with the committee. So I think there's two fundamental points in relation to this, and I think, Ms. Mackay, you've picked up on one of them, and that is that we are in a cycle of largely single-year budgets as a government. You know, as you say, that ultimately money is allocated on that Barnett basis from the UK government. And actually planning ahead when there's uncertainty beyond the current year is quite difficult. Now, that's not to say we don't work closely with the Treasury and the Department of Health and Social Care at a UK government level to understand expectations and plans, but in a formal sense, you know, even the budget this year will come after the autumn statement in Westminster. So we are working in that environment, and actually, I suppose, even over the last couple of years, with some of the general uncertainties we've seen around COVID money, pay and other things, actually that planning is quite difficult. But we do, so I think there's that challenge. But the second thing I would say is, yes, there is, you know, multi-year budgeting would absolutely help. But what we have tried to do, and we work very closely with health boards and integration authorities on this, is to give them some planning assumptions for future years. So if I take something like the drugs budget that we've mentioned already, there was a commitment for a £250 million investment over the lifetime of that parliament. So boards should be going away, IJBs, other partners, and working on that basis. You know, there's not any expectation that we will stray from that. If anything, you know, we would consider putting more investment into that. And I think we've done that across a number of areas, mental health, primary care, we've already mentioned, as well as some of the planned care investment. So, yes, there is that challenge, but we're trying to give, within that context, health boards, integration authorities, as many planning parameters as is possible.
That's great, thank you. And data is a particular bugbear of mine, and particularly how that informs budgets and outcomes as well. So how can data collection be improved to ensure it's not only sufficient to measure performance, but is also linked to long-term outcomes and therefore informing budgets and other things going forward?
Yeah, so Niamh might want to come in some of the specifics. So I would hope that actually at a strategic level there is evidence and information that's supporting all our budget decisions. So even if I take something as specific as some of the planned care investment that has been made over the last couple of years, and as that's considered as part of this budget, I think we will want to be absolutely clear what we expect boards to deliver and what improvements, in line with the trajectories that the Cabinet Secretary set out in the programme for government and in the mandate letter. We'll want to be absolutely clear on those outputs, and maybe there are more outputs than outcomes, but we would want to be absolutely clear on that. Equally, I mean, Niamh mentions the example of the multidisciplinary teams. We're starting to build up some really strong evidence about the difference that those teams are making across primary care, mental health and in other areas as well. So as we are working through this, and again, it's something that we'll be doing in conjunction with stakeholders, you're absolutely right, absolutely key that we draw on that data, and we're making sure that our budget investment decisions are based on where we're seeing that real impact and change. But Niamh, you work closely with Public Health Scotland, so I don't know if you want to say more in terms of their input in some of this.
Happy to briefly, if the committee member is content, because I know the committee have had a concern around the multiplicity of outcomes frameworks or other ways of understanding change. I guess the important thing there is understanding which data to go to for what purpose. So for some things where we're needing to track investment or needing to track activity, so inputs into the system, there will be things like previous LDP standards and that kind of activity. Really, and I think the committee member was asking about outcomes, how do we know we're making a difference on the outcomes we're seeking? And Public Health Scotland are our public body who are experts on prevention, and they're our experts on data and analysis. And there's work happening there, not trying to duplicate things like the National Performance Framework, but being really clear around what we know drives health and health inequalities, what the measures are around those, around early years, good work, good income, our outcome indicators around all that, and learning on the experience from COVID, so producing dashboards, working with the Improvement Service, so that they're useful locally in community planning when people are organising efforts to address health inequalities and health outcomes locally. And that Care and Wellbeing Dashboard, it's called, was launched in June. And that's really how we track progress on those overall outcomes. And evaluation, again, then is the key link between the data on our interventions and our activities, the data on the outcomes, and then what's plausibly driving those, both the things within the gift of the Scottish Government as a whole, and obviously wider factors, of which there has been a number in the last decade.
I'm now going to move to Carol Malkin.
Thank you very much. I think that this question probably just links in to what you've just been saying, but I'm interested to know if and how the Scottish Government tracks spending by NHS Board on what are their current Scottish Government policy priorities.
Yeah, so I'll bring Niamh maybe in a second on a couple of the specifics, but in a general sense, we obviously work through our policy teams within government, and whether it's in relation to specific commitments on mental health or alcohol or drugs, we work very closely with our boards and IJBs to get information and have that information returned to us where there's clarity on not just the spend, but as you say, crucially, what investment is being made on that spend and what early outcomes are starting to be seen. At a data level, and again, this speaks to work that Public Health Scotland do, we on an annual basis have a cost book which shows, which translates essentially the budget and what has been invested by the Scottish Government, and looks and tracks across to how that has then been spent by our health boards. And that starts to give a good picture, although there's a lag in time, there's a few months after the year end that we get that information. That gives us a good sense that the areas where we're focused on investing, which we've mentioned, and looking to see more investment in the community, is that being borne out in reality. And the past two to three years have been difficult, and they've skewed that probably somewhat because of the challenge of the pandemic. But we're building that evidence and data back up in terms of that overall cost book data, and that's something that we'll certainly be looking to build on as we move forward. But I'm not sure if there's anything you want to add, Niamh.
I can briefly add, so Richard's spoken about tracking investment, and I know the member was also asking about outcomes by board against things like the prospectus and the commitments in there. So that dashboard that I mentioned that Public Health Scotland have launched now, all the data in there on the evidence that we know influences health and health outcomes is available by health board area. It can be broken down. It's at an early stage now, so information is getting added to that, and there's work happening, if it's available by local authority area, work happening to make that breakdown available. So that's one part of the kind of tracking outcomes by geography. And the second part is just, I suppose, to amplify Richard's point about investment is clearly critical in prevention, not least investment out with the health and social care budget. So those very big investments in things like the Scottish Child Payment. But when we look back maybe over the last 20 years in some of the things that have made the biggest difference in public health and in preventing ill health and in improvements in mortality, for example, in cardiovascular disease, really the role of legislation has been very important there too. So some of those non-fiscal interventions, things like the smoking ban in 2006 and that kind of package of things over time. And I know that was in the written submission from PHS too. So I hope that's helpful.
Yeah, helpful. I suppose just to come back a little bit about, so sometimes particularly in big spends, and then you're trying to see where money's moved about, do you think there could be more, or do you think we could record anything differently or in a better way to ensure scrutiny and transparency of where some of the money actually goes once it's in the system?
Yeah, I mean, I think... you know, in some ways, if we take the budget as an example, and it's rightly so, but we, you as a committee, will see that by often sort of large spend areas, whether that's in planned care or other areas, and then broken down by health board. But you don't necessarily get that detail and data of how it's subsequently spent. I mean, I mentioned the cost book. I think that's really critical, actually, in terms of the translation through, and is the budget that we've set, is that coming through, and is that being shown in the spend that's ultimately being been taken forward by health boards and others? But it's something that I think, you know, we will want to do, and we are doing more on as we move forward with some of these key investment areas that we've talked about. And actually, it's something that we'd welcome coming back to the committee on and giving you that data, because I think it's really important and helpful for you, obviously, to see that as well.
Yeah, just to close off, I think, you know, there have been advances in mental health service budgets, and we can see more clearly. And just on what you're saying there, the scope to look at other areas, I think would be very helpful for members and for the committee as a whole. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Carol. I'm now going to move to Sandish Gulghani.
Thank you, convener. I suppose my question is very similar to Carol's, because I would just like to know if you feel that we have enough transparency in the way that money is spent, taxpayers' money is spent, and our ability to really track it so that we know where all that money is going.
Yeah, so I hope that... So there's no secret in terms of that the investment that we put into the health and social care system, and I would hope if there's information that you as a committee feel you're not seeing or you would like more on, then I would be really pleased to actually give you that, because I think you know, it's absolutely critical that you can see that and you are able to hold us to account on those things. I mean, I think in answer to the question, yes, I do think we've got good information in terms of the cost data that we have, but we can always improve it as well. And I think there's I would see it at two levels in particular, Dr. Gulghani. So I think at a health board and IJB level, it's absolutely important that for local communities, they've got a clear sense of where boards and integration authorities are investing their spend. Now, we do get annual reports by both integration authorities and health boards which set out that. And I think that does give that detail, at least on an annual basis, which gives a sense of how that money that has been allocated to those areas has been taken forward. And I think that's absolutely critically important. Similarly, at a national level, we are pulling through I've mentioned the cost book already, in terms of that data, in terms of overall spend. But we have also, as a government, we've asked on specific areas, integration authorities in particular, to detail how they've used particular funding streams. Mental health is one that Ms. Mocken mentioned, but there are other areas as well where we've got that information, and we are pulling through that data. But if we can do more to give the committee that information, or indeed make that public, then be very happy to do that, because I think it's absolutely important that we're transparent in that tracking of spend.
Thank you. It's just in previous sessions that we've had, we've been told that it's very difficult to track where the money has been spent and how the money's been spent and where it's going. So that's why I asked my question, because I think it's very important that we are able to transparently and very clearly define where taxpayers' money is going. Just from your answer, do you feel that you can track all the money that's being spent and exactly where it's going?
So, I mean, it's a huge budget, obviously, and there is investment made in many different areas and many different kind of priorities across health and social care. But, I mean, as I say, I think at a local level, health boards and IJBs can certainly provide a lot of that data and a lot of that information. And as I say, indeed, they already are in the annual reports that they produce. Follow up and we track in terms of all investment. And going back to Ms. Mackay's earlier question, I mean, one of the absolutely key things, particularly in the financial constraints that we will have and we'll see likely over the next few years, is we need to be confident that the investment we are making is actually having the differences that we want to see happen. So, there can be challenges. There can be challenges getting that information back in a timely way. We want to make sure the information is accurate, going back to your earlier question. But I think there is a clear way that we will and we can track through that spend, and certainly on some of the specific policy areas that we have already picked up on or touched on today, then yes, absolutely. And as I say, I'd be more than happy to provide as much of that to the committee as you would find helpful.
Thank you. And just to declare my interest as a practicing NHS GP, convener.
Thank you. I now move to Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, convener. And certainly many, many of the questions that I had today have already been answered and touched upon there. I suppose, you know, we've heard about the wellbeing dashboard, and we do hear a lot that short-term targets can drive the decision-making. So really interested in those longer-term objectives. And what can we be doing to encourage that budgets are really set with this in mind?
Yeah, so Niamh might want to say a little bit more maybe about even the care and wellbeing portfolio and the work that's being taken forward there. But I think just as a sort of starting point, and again going back to the programme for government and the mandate letter that was issued about a month or so ago, I mean, that will be the primary consideration and primary driver as we take forward our budget considerations. And I think the Cabinet Secretary has been absolutely clear that it's about recovery and reform and holding those two things together. And we know that there are certain immediate pressures on in secondary care, and there are immediate pressures in both planned and unscheduled care, where if there is additional investment that can be made and made in an effective way, then we should look at the options of taking that forward. And indeed, some of the investment that we've seen around things like hospital at home has been absolutely to support that. But I think the point is I wouldn't just see that as a short-term investment. So hospital at home, if I give that as an example, yes, we hope that will have an impact this winter and help the unscheduled care challenges that we'll undoubtedly face this winter. But this is a long-term solution as well, actually. And the outcomes for care and treatment at home are good and better for those that receive that. So I do think there is a balance to be struck by recognising, yes, there is that short-term investment, but we do see that playing out with a longer term in mind as well. But I think that reform element is absolutely key. We're using the care and wellbeing portfolio, which I think the committee has received evidence on before. I think it was maybe discussed at the PFG session with a CABSEC on. And I think that will be a really key mechanism for driving forward some of the reform which you mentioned. But I don't know, Niamh, if there's anything specific that you'd want to pick up on beyond what we've already said.
Maybe touch on, actually keeping people's experiences at the centre of that as well. Thanks.
So, yes, absolutely. There's the portfolio. The point of it is to be the long-term reform place around both population health, so those big risk behaviours that we've spoken about already in the context that reduce them, and service reform, and also whole system, including sort of wider government, so that $3 billion investment in tackling poverty, for example, absolutely critical around benefits and those building blocks of health. But that long term, the point of the portfolio is to try and bring those reforms all into one place. And so there's work on, besides the service reform we've spoken about or the population health we've spoken about, those measures, work on things like innovation, digital, analysis, really building those capabilities, I guess, in Scotland so that we're best able to deal with long-term challenges. One of those other big cross-cutting areas is co-design, service design and engagement. And I know the committee may have already heard about some of the summer design events this morning around national care service development. So part of that has been the establishment of a lived experience expert panel. And we know that when we speak to people, people don't live in policy siloed lives. You know, if we're speaking about our experiences of social care, often that will extend to our experiences of healthcare services locally. And that information is all being gathered together and used to inform that thinking around the long-term reform and building that sort of building block around constant public engagement that we need in order to reform services for the long term.
Thank you. And I suppose that kind of leads me on to my next question as well there. And I'm wondering, how can the interdependencies between different spending areas be better taken into account when making budget systems and we're looking at performance frameworks?
I mean, I'll take this in the first instance. I think there's a couple of things. I mean, Niamh's touched already on when we talk about some of the primary prevention, actually a lot of that spend is well outside of the health and social care portfolio. So I think one of the really key things is that as we move forward, not just with this budget, but actually subsequent budgets as well, is that there is that real clear connection across whether it's education, justice, housing, local government, that it is a whole system and it is a whole package, and there's that consideration over a number of areas. Within the portfolio as well, though, I think there is a lot that we are doing, and no doubt there is more we could do. So we know, I mean, we've talked about primary care and that being, that place where most interactions happen in our health and social care system, or certainly in our health system. And I think some of the work that's been done around multidisciplinary teams that we've touched on, community link workers as well, is having a real impact on some of the investment that we're having in relation to mental health and in relation to some other conditions as well. So we're starting to build up that we're not seeing within our own portfolio that siloed approach, but we're trying to make sure that our investment is coming together through the portfolio that Niamh's mentioned, so that we're not, we're making the best funding decisions and making sure that it reaches the people in the best way that it possibly can. Thanks.
I can add a specific example if the member would find that useful. So we spoke a little about benefits there and about things like the Scottish Child Payment and the impact on the building block of addressing poverty. Now, obviously, that impact on preventing ill health is only felt if individuals claim or have access to the benefits that they're entitled to. So there's a lot of work happening in the interdependencies between NHS services and wider services to ensure income maximisation. NHS Lothian is a recent example where they've established income maximisation services now across every hospital in the NHS Lothian estate. And they're starting to gather management information around that. So in the 9 months just up until June this year, over 700 patients, often at vulnerable points in their lives, obviously accessing healthcare, got the benefit of that income maximisation service, a kind of whole systems funded partly by NHS Lothian charity, managed by and overseen as well by the kind of public health experts in NHS Lothian. And some of that management information, some of that kind of confirmed financial gain is around £400,000 just in that 9 month period. So it's that combination of national interdependencies and then local action, because as I said, the impact on preventing ill health is only experienced where households have the benefit of those national policy changes in things like the Scottish Child Payment.
That's great. A great example. Thanks very much.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the panel for their contributions so far. Just to turn to health and social care outcomes, a lot of written submissions to the committee have noted that the short-term nature of national targets is impacting clinical priorities for investment, with decisions often made to satisfy expectations in the short term as opposed to measuring long-term impact with patient investment. Do the panel have a view on alternative measures that could be used to monitor performance that allow for longer-term planning and more rational decision-making on investments as a result?
Yeah, I mean, obviously this is a consideration for ministers in the first instance. I think, you know, probably in terms of the investment decisions or the choices that we're making, I don't see it as an either-or in some ways, in that we know that there are particular immediate or more immediate standards that you know, are referenced, for example, in the programme for government and improvements that we want to see. And I think that's absolutely right and absolutely the expectation of the population, and certainly in terms of some of our investment decisions, that's certainly where you know, we're making sure that that's absolutely factored in. But I think, you know, there is you know, a key need that we do have an eye to that longer term, and that we aren't you know, we're not just making those kind of short term financial decisions that will meet the immediate pressures. I mean, I do think the MAT standards that we've seen in relation to the National Drugs Mission, I think, is a really important one, where you see this combination of, yes, we want to see improvement in the short term. However, there is a longer term need to address and a longer term challenge as well. I think we can build up more, and actually the work that Public Health Scotland are doing to look at some of that data over a longer period will help to inform, as the members said, some of those longer term targets that we should have. But I think it's that, you know, and certainly I think in terms of where we are getting to in terms of the budget choices that we have, it's finding that right balance between those immediate service needs and that longer term focus as well.
Thank you. Have you got a further question, Mr. Sweeney?
Yeah, sorry, I was just waiting for the unmuting to happen. Sorry about that. I think that point is fairly made. However, I've recently met, for example, with GPs in Glasgow who have said they're so focused and overwhelmed, really, with dealing with the immediate clinical requirements that any headspace, any time available to look at continuous improvement, process improvement with their teams in practice is just not feasible. There isn't the capacity or space to do that sort of activity. And that really goes to the core of the tension between short-term firefighting and longer-term continuous improvement. The biggest commodity in NHS is, of course, time. So how do we try and move the organisation as a learning organisation, if you like, away from that kind of short-term firefighting in crisis mode into creating that space for continuous improvement, for work streams that can help to drive that activity. Is there an account management service, for example, or is there specialisms you're bringing in from other industries? I know a lot of economists say, you know, look to the aerospace industry, for example, for good examples on how to drive productivity. Obviously, the NHS is the single biggest employer in Scotland. It's going to have a national impact on performance. How do we move to getting the everyday economy in areas like the NHS actually mobilised in the same way? How do we bring that culture of productivity improvement into the NHS? Have you any ideas on how that can be achieved?
Yeah, I know. I think it's a really, really fair challenge back. And I think one of the realities, as the whole committee will know, is we are in a context where after 2 or 3 years where a lot of our services, for understandable reasons, were scaled back or curtailed, has meant that we do have a backlog that does mean that there is a real challenge in the immediate, and actually that investment is really important. I mean, I think specifically, I'll bring Stephen in a second in terms of some of the work that we're doing with system leaders to try and look at that question about developing our staff, leadership, productivity, all those points. I think particularly on the primary care point that you raised, Mr. Sweeney, I think that is a challenge. I think the investment that has been made around multidisciplinary teams, where we have seen a growth of over 4,500 MDTs now working in our system in Scotland, I think that is going to have an impact. It's something that we're looking at in future, and you know, in terms of the pressure that there are on GPs, as given the example you've highlighted, you know, that's something where we hope that will have an impact and assist GPs as we move forward. And clearly phase two of the contract is going to be a kind of key part of that. And I know you've got evidence from primary care colleagues coming up where I'm sure they'd be happy to expand on some of these points. But I think your point about productivity is right in that there is partly something about the money that we invest, but it's also making sure that we get the best value for the money that we invest as well, and making sure that we are as productive a system that we can possibly be, whilst recognising that our staff have obviously been through some really significant challenges in many instances over the last couple of years. So, I think it's holding that balance in line. I don't know if, Steve, you want to talk about some of the work that we've done with our staff to support as well.
Yeah, happy to. I suppose I'd just pick up a couple of broad strategic points and then maybe a couple of particular examples just in terms of that overarching question on productivity. One of the things that we've tried to do through framing the new National Health and Social Care Workforce Strategy, which we published in March 2022, was draw out the relationship between recruitment, staff development, training, and the infrastructure, tech, and tools in which they do the staff do their jobs. And part of what we're now trying to embed through the Workforce Strategy implementation programme is drawing out some of the links in terms of that relationship, particularly between where staff are working and how staff are working in terms of their relationship between one team and another, and their access to tools and equipment. So in addition, I suppose just picking up the point that Richard was making in terms of trying to kind of encourage whole system recovery post-acute phase of the pandemic, we've invested, as set out in the strategy, quite significantly, I suppose, both in physical and psychological supports for staff, both to not only to kind of encourage attendance, but also to allow them to sort of reset and rebalance themselves post-pandemic. Richard's already picked up the point about the growth in staffing in MDTs, and we can see through the National Monitoring and Evaluation Strategy, through some locality-based evidence, where that is already having an impact in terms of releasing, in relation to your question, GP time, through embedding sort of additional physio support, community link worker support, and also pharmacotherapy support, and that's also demonstrating a more efficient use of resources with better patient outcomes, particularly in relation to some of the pharmacotherapy examples. We've also, looking at, our approach to planned care recovery, staffing and productivity, in partnership with the Centre for Sustainable Delivery, looked at a range of interventions that try and increase the productive opportunity within those centres without, and I have to stress that, meaning that staff are working more hours or doing more work. It's about aligning, the whole of that system end to end and looking at the productive capacity across the whole of our estate within NHS Scotland. So through the National Elective Coordination Unit, for instance, we've managed to utilise what was previously a little fallow capacity in certain theatres throughout the country, delivering about 3,500 so far over the course of this year, additional elective procedures. And we've also been looking at, the structuring of teams and workforce diversification within that area in particular, to try and progressively improve productivity without increasing the burden on the direct burden on staff in frontline services.
Thanks for that. Do you feel that, certainly lean improvements, continuous improvement is very much driven by the ground up, and it's often the innovators at the front line who can have the best insights on what we need to do to improve productivity and efficiency. With that in mind, do you feel that we could do more in terms of continuous professional development, in terms of even looking across different agencies of the Scottish Government, such as Scottish Enterprise, the Scottish Manufacturing Advisory Service, to perhaps teach more tools and techniques that could allow more practitioners within the National Health Service to sort of identify opportunities where there are waste and where opportunities for efficiency could be achieved, and start to organically develop those ideas and move them forward?
Yeah, I mean, I'll come in the first instance. I don't know if Steve might want to add a couple of things, but maybe just giving one example. I think you're right in terms of, often it's our staff who have those good ideas and have those ideas in terms of how we can improve our working. I mean, if I take a specific example about in relation to climate, the National Green Theatre's work that we are taking forward has been clinician-led. Clinicians, particularly in NHS Highland, have come together and seen actually that there is not just efficiencies in terms of monetary or productive efficiencies, but actually from a climate and sustainability perspective, some of the work that's been done around anaesthetic gases, some of the work around waste separation, that's all been led by, it's not been an edict from on high, albeit, we're very focused in terms of the work that's going on in relation to sustainability. But that was something, that theatre's project, that was absolutely led by teams in the system. And I think you're right, how we harness that is going to be key going forward, because that's often where the best innovative ideas come from. That said, there is wider harnessing. You mentioned Scottish Enterprise, across certainly our innovation landscape, we're doing a lot of work with colleagues in Scottish Enterprise and in the economy directorate within the Scottish Government around some of the research projects that we have underway, and we've seen some real benefit coming through in that in terms of some of the work around closed loop diabetes in relation to theatre scheduling and other things. So there's quite a lot of innovative work that can be done. We need to make sure that we invest that and people have the time to focus on that. But I think that's something that given the challenges we face, is absolutely right. We drive forward. I don't know if anything you'd want to add, Steve?
I suppose just a couple of other practical examples. So we, again, through our work on elective recovery, we did a bit of a bottom-up approach in terms of developing staffing models directly with theatre teams across the national treatment centres that have opened or are in the process of opening over the course of this year, particularly with Highland and with Fife and with the Golden Jubilee, where we were actually, looking at and inviting staff themselves, clinical staff, to challenge assumptions around staffing, the staffing model and the staffing mix, and inviting them also, to engage with some of those some of the challenges that there are in the wider kind of economy around attraction of particular groups of staff, and looking at what alternative staffing solutions there might be. That led to some positive change in terms of rethinking the mix in particular in the centre in Inverness, rebalancing the number of registrants who'd support staff, and also begins to feed into something of a bit of a pipeline when you tie it together with the work that's being done around anchors and future development. That being said, there is obviously, I think, going to have to be an increased focus on, I suppose, the productive capacity and opportunity that might come through future technological innovation, both in terms of how our staff work and the tools that they have to do their jobs. And that, again, is something that we framed in outline within the National Workforce Strategy. There's some further work to do in terms of scoping, I suppose, where we might be over the next 5 to 10 years in terms of AI. There's quite a lot being done in the context of the Innovation Authority in terms of AI and imaging and how that supports imaging staff as well, but it can also support with the administration of staffing potentially and how they're rostered and used throughout the system. So there's some systems innovation as well that is, I suppose, being driven by the wider landscape that we can look to embed as part of kind of managing that overall approach to balancing staffing productivity and service need going forward.
Thanks very much, convener.
Thank you. We have limited time left and we still have quite a few questions to ask. So if I can ask contributors to be brief, and with that I have to practice what I preach, I'll make a declaration that I'm a registered mental health nurse. And I'm keen to move on to workforce and pay. And I'm keen to explore how the twin pressures of increased pay and demands for additional staff can be balanced in the NHS and social care within the limited resources of the Scottish Government budget, and obviously its limited borrowing powers. So I don't know if perhaps that's one for you, Stephen.
I'm happy to make a start. I suppose at the outset, we took a clear overall strategic approach in reaching the pay settlements we have this year, both for Agenda for Change staff and for doctors. Doctors and dentists about seeking to make a fair, proportionate and reasonable settlement in the context of the wider economic circumstances, and also managing, looking to proactively minimise the disruption that would have occurred if there'd been a breakdown in industrial relations. I think there's two points about the balance looking ahead, if I can, and I'll try and be as brief as possible. I think one is that you have to look at the totality of terms and conditions. So whilst we've made the investments that we have over the course of this year, and obviously pay will continue to be determined, you know, going forward through that tripartite process directly with unions, we are looking at the balance of investment in pay going forward with progressive terms and conditions reform, because it's the total package, when you look internationally at the benchmarks, that makes careers in health and social care attractive. And in the context, I suppose, of present day shortages in health and social care personnel, retention is as important, if not more important, particularly as we have acute pressures, than thinking about when you compare it with investment in recruitment, should I say. That's not to say that you spend on one in favour of the other, but you have to, I suppose, take those strategic decisions in the total kind of economic context in which we're operating.
Okay. Thank you, and thank you for your brevity in that complex answer. I'm now going to move to Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. I will be quick, because a lot of information has been covered already. And when we took evidence in the last session, they talked a lot about like whole systems approaches to the budget, because we need to tackle poverty. We need to look at health inequalities. It impacts on housing. It's loads of umbrellas that need to help support improving the health of the people in Scotland. So I'm interested in the public health aspects of it and the preventative approaches, and I'm interested in, you know, like better ability to have good healthy diets, for instance. I'm interested in the work of Henry Dimbleby and Chris Van Tulleken, and what Professor Pekka Puska did in Finland in order to improve the diet and reduce cardiovascular disease. So what work is being done to learn from other researchers that aren't even in Scotland to look at how we can, I suppose, budget better for public health measures?
Sure. I'll bring in Niamh, who will be able to give some of the specifics on that. But you're right. I mean, ultimately, it all comes back to evidence-based budgeting, and I think that's what we are seeking to do on a kind of global scale, but even on a kind of granular scale. So we talk about diet and obesity and the investment that we're putting in there. You know, really key for us when we're making those investment decisions, when the policy teams are considering this, is what is that international evidence showing us, and what can we, you know, how can we evaluate that as effectively as possible so that that investment that we're making really maximises the contribution that we're putting in. But Niamh, I don't know if you want to say anything more specific given we're short of time.
I'll be brief. I mean, it's exactly as members of the committee on the NCD Alliance report said, you know, it's that whole package of measures in terms of learning from other systems. If we think about the criticality of early years, Heckman curve, return on investment, you know, that's part of the nutrition policy landscape as well. So the free vitamins to under threes or to breastfeeding mothers. So that kind of whole system approach to the example you used of kind of diet and healthy weight has to start at the very, 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 very earliest, and then has to be that whole package of measures, including legislative as well as fiscal. And I know when Minister for Public Health and Women's Health was here for the PFG session recently, she was signposting that the next step on the promotions around and trying to restrict promotions around foods high in fat, sugars and salt, which I know has got a strong overlap with some of those Dimbleby concerns you mentioned earlier. And that's certainly, you know, very active work on bringing that forward as soon as possible.
And the Institute for Fiscal Studies have a report out about future planning and short and medium term and long term planning as well, which is interesting. And they focus on basically the Scottish Government's budget for health depends on Barnett consequentials, so it's determined by the UK government. So does that pose challenges in planning if we don't know what is coming from the UK government, for instance, in order to determine what needs to be incorporated into whether it's preventative health planning or acute planning?
Yeah, I mean, it sort of loops back to Ms. Mackay's question earlier. I mean, it generally, at the moment, we are getting those consequentials on an annual basis, albeit we've got some assumptions that we're making into future years. I mean, obviously, once the total Scottish Government budget comes, ministers can choose to use that how they wish. But if we were to put even more into health, that would be at the expense of other portfolios that have, you know, equally pressing needs, and actually already, as a government, you know, in the last year, in excess of consequentials has been put towards the health and social care budget. So it is a challenge, and that's something that needs to be worked through. But within that context, we're trying to make sure that, you know, we have a clear financial framework as far as we can that we use to make the decisions that will impact over the next 5 to 10 years.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. And we're going to go over to Paul Sweeney for one final brief supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Just intrigued about the practical realities of how do you pivot the healthcare system from current acute spend in hospitals towards preventative spend within communities. We know that we spend more on acute hospitals than any other healthcare system in the developed world. How do we practically shift the balance?
Yeah, so I mean, it does link to a lot of what we've said. I think there will be it's partly about some of that upfront investment that we've made. And I think, you know, building on some of the investment that's been made in some of these preventative areas will need to continue. I don't necessarily see the two as an either or, and I think that you know, there is you know, something about important that we do continue to invest in our our kind of secondary care services and make sure that that funding is available and as we need. But I think it's going to be partly through some of those deliberate budget choices, but not just budget choices, some of the policy choices that don't necessarily come with huge financial costs as well, that will start to help to shift some of that narrative and shift some of that service delivery.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I thank the panel for their attendance this morning and for the evidence that they have given to the committee. At our next meeting on the 24th of October, we plan to take further evidence on the National Care Service Scotland Bill, and that concludes the public part of our meeting today.